Sam, from Michigan, clearly consumer sentiment is not a problem at this point.
Oh, not a problem at all. And two indicators that I look at to see whether we're heading for recession is year-over-year percent change in housing starts. Every recession since 1960 was preceded by a double-digit decline. Along with that, we had a double-digit decline on average in consumer sentiment. And neither of those indicators is flashing anything other than a very bright green.
Same thing with triple dollar or triple-digit oil, right, Mikey? Right. Generally, you want to see that before you start declaring
recessions.
Yeah,
I mean, among all the things that have to line up, that's not in the picture. I don't think the question right now is the market kind of in suspense as to whether we're tipping into recession. What I do find fascinating is the market seems to be able to gain comfort in these lagging economic data points from the United States that look good, but we don't really know if we can extrapolate that through this quarter or beyond. So market continues to kind of say, okay, the bond market is showing some worry. We're hiding in the parts of the stock market that aren't quite as directly exposed to what we're afraid of right now. The question is how long that
It's not all great. I mean, retail sales, if you go into the core control group, which actually feeds into GDP, was zero. Mm-hmm. And yes, the expectation was for a rise. So are there mixed signals as to where the consumer's going?
I would say mixed signals. I've seen some other people slice that number and say, oh, it's okay if you look at it. But I think the consumer, I don't think the consumer is aggressively strong, has ever been really all that valid. It's been steady. And I think it's hard to come off that idea, at least so far, that the consumer is at least steady.
Feels like it would take a lot more now for the market to seriously get unnerved by a coronavirus headline, right?
Absolutely.
Why has that happened?
Well, I think historically, if you go back to 2003 with SARS, H1N1, Ebola, Zika, MERS, et cetera, when you look to the 1, 2, and 3 months after the first U.S. reported case, every observation was positive, with the average gain 3 months after being more than 10%. So basically, history tells us this is something that will become a top-line event, but not end up becoming a bottom-line event.
And as we said with Jim a moment ago, maybe some disinflation in there, and that's what bonds are saying?
Possibly. I mean, the Fed basically told us the last time that Fed Chair Powell spoke was lower for longer, because they want to make sure that they can get that PCE number up to and maybe even slightly above their target of 2.0%. They know how to fight inflation. They're not very good at fighting deflation.
I mean, I think high liquidity, slow growth environment where the United States markets, both stocks and bonds, seem like the haven, that's probably what the markets are saying.
Still, I mean, the uncertainty factor does appear high. We're questioning the accuracy of the data coming out of China. We're questioning how quickly this virus is spreading. Are money managers that you're talking to and investors you're talking to surprised by the market's resilience to all of that?
I think there's a general surprise, but also they probably wish there was more of a dip. So I think the answer to the question of could we be blindsided by something coming out of developments in this story, I think, tell me where the market trades to. If the market gets even that much more stretched, if valuations continue to build and earnings estimates don't go up that much, that creates the vulnerability right there.
B of A's out today, Sam. They count 800 rate cuts since the crisis around the world. And they say we remain irrationally bullish because positioning is not yet euphoric. You got any problem with that?
Well, a little bit. I mean, I think that the Dow is ensnared in a tractor beam right now and being pulled up toward that 30,000 level. And I think as we make each step, well, we're getting more and more vulnerable, because the P.E. on forward 12-month earnings on the S&P is 19.5, according to S&P Capital IQ consensus. The last time we were that high was coming out of an earnings recession in 2002. So we're almost 20, you know, at the highest level in almost 20 years.
So you think 20 is the ceiling on a forward P.E.?
Well, the last time we got to this level, we did see a minor pullback in prices. I think that basically we need to eclipse that 30,000 level, which becomes a rusty door that's going to require several attempts before it finally swings open.
Well, Barron's did put it on the cover a couple weeks
ago. That's true, although it was a little more of like this is where we're seemingly headed as opposed to a bold call. Look, I do think that B of A call, it's plausible, and he's been right. Michael Hartnett over there has been right about saying, look, wait for people to really get super aggressive. But the question is, how much are you actually playing for now? I mean, how close are we to that moment when we do get real reckless or real excessive positioning? I'm not sure.
I mean, one of the, just going back to the coronavirus and the market's resilience and the Fed, is that Jay Powell this week said, we're watching the coronavirus as a downside risk. We stand ready and willing to act, and that's all the market needs to hear.
Sure, but the parts of the bond market are even pushing for the idea of a March cut right now. And so your question is, how big do the market's eyes get on something like that, and does it come on time? And I agree with you, that's the backdrop and the backstop for this market.
I mean, German GDP, did you see flat GDP, expectations for a rise in GDP? Singapore's prime minister overnight warning of a recession. A lot of the Asian economies already feeling it. Mexico cutting interest rates preemptively. And this is adding up to be a big weight on global growth.
It is, and I think you'd say, yep, and the banks and the energy stocks and the transports aren't doing anything. And so I think that might be where the market is trying to kind of sequester the pain, if it can.
Finally, really quick, on political dynamics, is the market applauding Bloomberg's surge? Is it discounting a Sanders nom? What do you think we are there?
Possibly discounting a Sanders surge, figuring that we're not going to be changing horses in midstream. Let's continue with the current administration and that we don't inject any additional uncertainty.
Yeah, I mean, with, you know, the president's reelection odds have been moving in sync with the market higher. So I think, however you want to slice it, what it means for the Democratic side.
And job approval and Gallup sentiment, all that stuff.